You know, one of my closest friends in the world is a guy named Hansel. His name is Hans Bowman, and we met 10 years ago. I was preaching at a revival down in the area of Arkansas where he's from. We met. He ended up working for me, and then now he's the associate pastor at the church that he attends, and we have a great relationship, and over that relationship, I got to know his dad. His dad is a guy named Clint. Clint is a car guy. When I first met Clint, he showed me his pride and joy. It was a 73 Mustang, and it was bright red, and it was sharp. And I remember him saying, "Let me turn it on for you, and let me let you hear what happens under the hood." And he turned it on, and it, you know, just that muscle car sound. And so I remember, you know, a few years ago, I went back to Arkansas. I went and seen Clint, and I said, "Clint, where's the Mustang?" And he said, "I traded it. Let me show you what I bought." And he traded the Mustang, and this is a picture of what he bought. He bought a 72 Corvette Stingray, and it's black. It's chromed out. It looks awesome. And I saw that car. I was like, "I want to ride. All right, Clint, I need to ride in this." And I said, "Turn it on. Let me hear the engine." He said, "Well, it don't run." "So what do you mean, Clint?" And he said, I said, "The Mustang ran and this doesn't." He said, "I know, but I'm going to make this one run eventually." and I found it interesting that there was a car that looked incredible on the outside. If you looked at it from the outside, it was immaculate. There was nothing that compared to it, just like it was off the showroom floor. But no matter how good it looked on the outside, when you popped the hood, it didn't work. Everything that it had the potential to do, it couldn't accomplish because there was no engine. It didn't run. And really, I hope you realize that this series, as we cleverly titled it Under the Hood, has been our attempt to show you and to remind you that we're not just a church that looks good externally, but there's a lot of things that go on under the surface. There's a lot of things that are happening under the hood, that what you see on social media and what you see in our buildings is just it's the tip of the iceberg of all that we do, that under the hood looks even better than what looks on the outside. And so we've been in this series showing you what drives Cape First and what makes us do all that we do. And we talked 3 weeks ago about step one and how everything we put our hand to, whether it's life groups or our second Sunday services or outreaches events, it's all about knowing God, our heart. The number one things that drives us as a church family, the key that starts the car, is how can we get people who are far from God a little bit closer? How can we get them to a place where they know God? And then in the next part of the journey is the step of finding freedom and deliverance and wounds that are from their past where they can get healed from that. And last week, Pastor Gary preached an incredible message on the third step in this journey with God, on growing in your purpose. And today, we finalize this series with our fourth value, and that is this, is that God has it for everyone in this room to go and use their life to make a difference. I want you to say that word with me, go. Will you say it with me? Go. That's what he wants. After you have come to know him, you've been delivered and healed, and you've found freedom, and then you have grown in your purpose, the last and final step is to go and make a difference. It's really, if we were to use the same car analogy, this is the point where we get to put the pedal down and we let the rubber meet the road, and we see how fast this thing can go. Anybody ever drove a really fast car? I remember when I first met my wife, I lived down in the Boot Hill. She lived in Dexter. It was an hour drive, and so I drove an hour to pick her up at her home. And I remember when I pulled into the driveway of her parents' home where she lived at, and the first thing I saw, this is 2012, she had a brand new 2011 Camaro. And it wasn't just a regular Camaro. It was sharp. It was decked. She had custom pinstripes, and the wheels were painted. And I'm going to be honest with you. I sat there in my truck, and I had one thought. I'm never going to be able to afford this girl. You know, I told her this story this week that I was going to tell this, and I said, "I'm going to tell him how I thought I could never afford you." And she looked at me and said, "You can't afford me." But I went on the first date, and we talked, and I realized Mom and Dad didn't buy the car for her. She had a job, and she bought the car herself. And I'll tell you what my second thought was. I'm going to get me a sugar mama. That was the second thought. And so I couldn't afford her, but she could afford me. So it worked out really well. And I remember getting in that Camaro the first time she let me drive it and pushing the pedal down. And the first time a car had ever thrown me back in the seat. It was, and if you've ever been in that situation, you know there's something exhilarating about pushing the pedal to the floor and seeing the power be released. And I tell you, in our walk with God and the journey that we go through at Cape First, step 1 through 3 prepares you for step 4. All that we've talked about has prepared you for this final stage where you get to push the pedal, get thrown back in the seat, and pursue everything that God has for you. Can I tell you that our walk with God is a journey? Our walk with God is it's a journey of progression. And here's what I have found in the last decade of ministry. In the last 10 years of ministry, nearly every person I've met, whether it's been praying in an altar, talking in the lobby, sitting down in a counseling session, grabbing lunch with somebody, nearly every person I've met in the last 10 years of ministry has had the dream, the desire that they wanted to make a difference with their life. They wanted to use their gifts, their talents. They wanted to know that when their time came to a close, that they had left something, they had been involved in something that was bigger than themselves. They wanted to make a difference. But can I tell you equally, I have found a large amount of people who want to accomplish step 4, but are not willing to go through steps 1 through 3. And so there's a lot of people who want to make a difference with their life, but they don't want to go through the process, the journey of progression in their walk with God, where they come to know Him. They allow Him to heal them of their past. They find out what their purpose is, and they develop it, and then they press the gas. You see, what I have discovered is what happens when you pursue step 4 without the first 3 steps is you get a car out of control. You get a car out of control. I remember this last November or so, my brother and my dad and I were out hunting together, and I'm the smallest of the 3 guys, okay? And we're all in this single bench side by side, and we're driving it across this flat thing. I pull my foot off the pedal, but the side by side doesn't stop, and I'm thinking, what in the world's happening? How can I get this thing to slow down? I didn't realize my brother's big foot had slipped over and hit the gas pedal, and I'm like, get off the gas pedal. But for that moment of panic where it was out of control, and I'm thinking, what do I do if I can't get this thing, you see, that's what a life is like when you try to go after, and you see it a lot. You see, because what happens is you end up in vain pursuits, vain relationships, vain career endeavors, vain college degrees, because you were trying to make a difference, but you weren't going through the process it takes to get you prepared to make a difference. And so step 4 is making a difference. And I would tell you that equally detrimental to your walk with God is people who are prepared to make a difference but will refuse to push their foot on the gas. You know what I found in our walk with God is that if the devil can't keep you lost, he'll keep you lazy. You see, the devil's number one plan for your life is to keep you lost, where you don't make a difference, where you end up wasting every gift that God has given you, and your eternal judgment finds you in hell. But if he cannot do that, the next thing he wants to do for your life is, if he can't keep you from going to hell, he wants to make sure you don't take anybody with you. And so we have to guard ourselves is to make sure that we don't become people who get saved but don't help anybody else get saved. We have to make sure that we use our life to make a difference. And today, it's all about putting the pedal to the metal and making a difference on the racetrack of life. In the Bible, in Matthew chapter 28, Jesus gives us one of his farewell speeches, and it's known as the Great Commission. It says this in Matthew chapter 28, verse 18. Jesus came to them, and he said, "All authority has been given to me in heaven and on earth. Go, therefore, and make disciples of all nations, baptizing them in the name of the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit, teaching them to observe all things that I have commanded you. And lo, I am with you always, even to the end of the age." If you're familiar, this is known as the Great Commission, where he commissioned us to go and make a difference in the world that we live in. If I could do a play on words, we would call it the Great Commission, because it's where Jesus gives us the opportunity to co-labor with him in his endeavor. And what is his endeavor? His endeavor is to reach people, introduce them to himself. The purpose of your life is to make a difference by reaching people for Jesus. Can I tell you, I can't give you every specific detail of your purpose. I don't know every faucet that you are supposed to. I don't know what your career path is supposed to be, but I will tell you this, that you are the solution to a kingdom problem. Your life is the solution to a kingdom problem. That when God picked the day of your birth, when he designed you in your mother's womb, when he created you with your sense of humor and your giftings and your qualifications and even your lineage, he took all of that and he factored it in because he had a kingdom problem in mind that he was designing your life to be the solution to. You see, you are the solution to a kingdom problem, and God will connect your dream to what he has called you to solve. Last week, Pastor Gary preached an incredible message on grow in purpose, and in that he shared that you were created to solve a problem, to fill a need. The greatest need in the world is for people to hear the gospel and have an opportunity to know Jesus. It's the greatest need in the world is for people to hear the gospel and have an opportunity to know Jesus. I'd like to put it this way, that until hell is empty and heaven is populated, we have a job to do, a problem to solve, and a purpose to fulfill. Until hell is empty and heaven is populated, we have a job to do. And another one of his farewell speeches, you know, Jesus is kind of like the Michael Jordan of basketball, come back a few times, and then finally he left. But in his final farewell, he said this in Acts chapter 1, verse 8. But you will receive power when the Holy Spirit comes upon you, and you'll be my witnesses, telling people about me everywhere, in Jerusalem, throughout Judea, in Samaria, and to the ends of the earth. So before he ascended into heaven, he looks at his friends and he says, there's going to be a power from the Holy Spirit that comes upon you. And that power is going to equip you to tell a whole world about me. It's going to equip you to tell Jerusalem, Judea, Samaria, and the ends of the earth. And he really gives us this geographical location, but it's a picture of the geographical areas of our life. And so you consider Jerusalem, that's your home. That's what you're close to. That's the people that you know. And then Judea and Samaria is the regional area around them. And then the ends of the earth would be the entire world. And so he said, I want you to go make a difference in your world. What is your world? Your world is your family. Your world is your neighbor. Your world is your classmates. Your world is your coworkers. Your world is your church. The first place that you are equipped to make a difference is at home. The first place that you are equipped to make a difference is in the family that God has placed you inside of. And I believe that. I take that serious. I promised my wife on the day we got married that I would never pastor a church more than I pastored my home, because I wasn't going to save the world and lose my family. And I believe that the number one place we are called to make an impact is to those that God has placed us in the middle of: our church, our home, our family, our coworkers. That's the people that are close to you. But he didn't just cap us off in that. He said, that's where we start. But then we go to Judea and Samaria. So we go, and then he gives us the power to go and make a difference beyond our world. That's the people that are on the fringe. That's the newcomer who walks into church. That's the ones that you haven't got a chance to know yet, but your story is going to overlap with their story. And somehow, some way, God's going to put you in a place where you can minister to them. And then he says to go into all the ends of the earth, and God equips us to make a difference in the whole world. And so that's a big endeavor. It's above my pay grade. How do I do that? You know, there's three ways that we do that consistently. We go with our giving. And every week, my wife and I sow into missions. And every week, every month, we sow into missionaries. And we do that because we know I can't go where they go all the time. But every time someone gets saved in Colombia, I feel like I have a part in it, because I have missionaries that I support in Colombia. And every time when pastor says we supplied the tuition for 18 college students to go to Bible college in South Africa, my name's on one of them because I gave in that offering. And I go with my giving, and I go with my praying. I pray for other countries. I pray for the lost in other nations. I pray for missionaries that are serving in those nations. And then we go with our going. And now COVID changed plans for 2020, but every year other than that, we take missions trips, and we go and we invest our time. We give. There are people who take vacation days and give weeks of their life to go to other places to help people come to know Jesus. So we go in our world, we go beyond our world, and then we go in to the whole world. That's where we go. That's the people we're called to. But how? How do you do that? I want to give you quickly four keys to making a difference. And here's the first key that we get in Acts chapter 1 is this: the Holy Spirit is the means to making a difference. Notice he didn't tell them to go until he told them how they were going to be equipped to go. because he said the Holy Spirit will come upon you. And then you'll have the power to go and be my witnesses. If we are going to populate heaven and empty out hell, it will be by the Holy Spirit empowering us to be light into darkness. You know, I was having breakfast this week at a local restaurant and was with another pastor, and I didn't know the waitress, but the waitress knew the guy I was with, and she came up to us at some point in the conversation and she said, "I want you guys to know, I don't say this superficially, but I'm praying for you pastors because this is a really dark time to be ministering in." And she went on to talk about some of the darkness that people see and how difficult she couldn't imagine our jobs being. And you know what? I appreciated the thought, and I certainly would take the prayer, and I appreciated the pureness of her heart because I knew what she meant. But I also sat there at that breakfast table thinking, I am not intimidated, and I'm not operating in fear of the darkness that's around me, because here's what I know. The light shines brightest in the darkness. And you know, I've been here, and I was made for such a time as this. We're not called to be afraid of the darkness. We're called to light up the darkness. That the Holy Spirit, I believe this, I believe the Holy Spirit's been working in our lives, our entire life, to prepare us for this moment. That everything we've ever been through, everything we've ever experienced, every pain, every hurt, every self-endeavor, all of it was for this moment, the Holy Spirit preparing us to be light into the darkness. Can I tell you, the Holy Spirit in you is eager to work through you to make a difference around you. So the Holy Spirit is the means of making a difference. But the love of Jesus is the mark of making a difference. I love what the Bible says in Ephesians chapter 1. He says, imitate God. It should be good to remember. Imitate God. Therefore, in everything you do, because you are his dear children, live a life filled with love, following the example of Christ. He loved us, and he offered himself as a sacrifice for us, a pleasing aroma of God. So imitate God. How do you imitate him? You live a life filled with love. You follow the example of Jesus, and he loved us, and he offered himself a sacrifice. You see, if you really want to make a difference with your life, it's going to come through sincere relationships where you appropriately reflect the love of Jesus. I want to tell you, I've never led anyone to the Lord through an argument or a rant. I've tried a few times. I've backspaced a lot on my keyboard over the years. But if you look at the model of Jesus, when he was trying to reach people and turn their hearts towards him, he didn't rant and he didn't ridicule. You see, the woman caught in adultery in John chapter 8, she didn't get a lecture, she got hope, because he said, neither do I condemn you. And when she didn't get condemned, her heart became postured towards him. You see, Zacchaeus didn't repent of his sins in Luke 19 because Jesus argued a point. He repented because Jesus had dinner with him and entered into his world. You see, even when Jesus hung on the cross and he was dying for all of our sins, he didn't spew a vile rebuke, but instead he said, Father, forgive them. They're not even aware of what they're doing in this moment. And you see the heart of Jesus when he was drawing people towards himself. It was from a place of love. Romans chapter 2 verse 4 says, don't you see how wonderfully kind, tolerant, and patient God is with you? Does this mean nothing to you? Can't you see that his kindness is intended to turn you from your sin? It's his kindness. It's his goodness. It's his love that draws people to himself. Now, let me help you. There's always a balance to this conversation. Please hear me. I'm not saying that it's our job to condone lifestyles that are contrary to the Word of God. That's not what I'm saying. But I don't have to condemn them either. I just have to give them hope. There's a difference between acceptance and approval. Could it be that Christianity is not about pointing out what's wrong with other people as much as it is about pointing out what's right with Jesus? That's what our job is to do. And if we are going to empty hell and populate heaven, it will be because we are marked by the love of Jesus. The third key is this: the visibility of Jesus is the measure of making a difference. Galatians chapter 6, the Message version, reads like this: live creatively, friends. If someone falls into sin, forgivingly restore them, saving your critical comments for yourself. That's a good word, right? You might be needing forgiveness before the day is out. Stoop down and reach out to those who are oppressed. share their burdens, and so complete Christ's law. If you think you're too good for that, you're badly deceived. Stoop down and reach out to those who are oppressed. When's the last time that you stooped down and reached out? I want you to recollect with me for a moment. Consider the day that you gave your heart to Jesus, that season of life, the moment that you got saved. Because what I have found is that most often when someone tells me that part of their story, they tell me about someone else who helped them in that part of their journey. There's a lot of times that when I tell people about the night I got saved, I tell them about Barbie Meeks, and I tell them about Nola Griffin, and I tell them about Tammy Cannon, and I tell them about my mama, and I tell them about these people who played a pivotal role in praying for me and believing for me. And really what they were doing is they were being the visible love of Jesus in my life. You see, we often, when we see Jesus or come to in a relationship with Jesus, it's because someone stooped down in the middle of our mess and reached out to us and helped us. A few weeks ago, I took my oldest daughter, Kendall. We went walking in the woods by our house, and you say, why do you do that? I just like walking in the woods sometimes, no reason. And we went for a walk in the woods, and on the way out of the woods back to the house, I tried to get my daughter to walk in front of me because I didn't want her to stumble and fall. And so I was trying to say, walk in front of me and I'll make sure. And she kept arguing with me because that's what 5-year-old girls do with their daddy. And they're professionals at it at an early age. And she said, you walk up front. And I said, why? She said, because I know you know where to go. And she was confident that I could get her out of where we were at. And can I tell you? There's a world out there looking for people that they can follow. There's a world of people out there caught up in darkness that are looking for people that they can trust to say, I don't know where you're going, but I know you can get me out of where I'm at. You see, you are primed and ready to be the light into somebody's darkness. You say, well how do I know and where would I be most beneficial at? Can I tell you that what God saved you from is a great indicator of how he wants to use you to help others find him? That sometimes the difficulty you overcame in your life is your way into someone else's world. Now, I want to help you. Don't do it too soon. You have to heal the wound, but then you show the scar. If you don't get healed and you go out too soon, what happens is we bleed all over people. And so you have to know God, and you have to get a find freedom, and then you have to grow in your purpose. But once you've done that and all that stuff is healed, you had the capability to go to other people and say, I never thought this wouldn't be infected. I never thought that this would go away. I never thought I wouldn't have a bandage on top of this. But somehow, some way, God showed up in my darkness and people helped me and people prayed for me and I got plugged into a church. And I want you to know, if he did it for me, he will do it for you. You see, if you're going to empty hell and populate heaven, it will be measured by how much Jesus people can see inside of you. Can people see Jesus in you? And then here's the fourth thing. The Great Commission is the motive for making a difference. We cannot wait for the world to show up at the front door of the church. It may be the understatement of all understatements, but the days where people show up at church on Sunday because that's what you're supposed to do have passed us by. And I think too often we sit in the lobbies of our church looking out the front doors of our buildings wondering when are people going to show up, and there's a lost and dying world looking out the front doors of their homes asking when's the church going to show up. You see, can I tell you, I don't want people to know Kate First as the building on Silver Springs Road. I don't even really want to know them because we had a concert or because we had a men's or women's event, although those are great things and you should bring your friends. But what I really want is for people to know Kate First because we showed up on their doorstep when they were at their lowest. I want them to know us because they were hungry and we fed them. I want them to know us because when their baby needed diapers, we gave them diapers. I want them to know us because we believed in them in the middle of their addiction. I want them to know us because when their world was shaken and they fell, we stooped down and we reached out. You see, I don't want them to know our logo as much as I want them to know your face, because we are the hands and feet of Christ. We are to co-labor with him and be part of the Great Commission of reaching people. You see, Jesus did not say, please send people in darkness to the church. He said, I'm sending the church into the darkness. That you are a city set on a hill. You are a light that cannot be hidden, that he placed inside of you everything you need to make a difference. If you are going to empty hell and populate heaven, it's going to be because we take the Great Commission seriously.